You see other guys on a loan who've won it, who have like stockpiles of frozen fish and half a moose and all this stuff. I was hand to mouth.
What was going on behind the camera, or maybe the stuff that didn't make the edit?
He had to bring me through those things to teach me those lessons.
Did not having your Bible with you?
I would say the number one thing I have learned.
This is Bible Memory Goal. My name is Josh. And what would happen if somebody dropped you off in the middle of nowhere with only a backpack and you had to survive on your own? That's what Dave McIntyre did on season 2 of the History Channel's Alone. And if you haven't seen that, it is so good. My family sat down and watched the entire season, and we loved watching Dave go through. And spoiler alert, if you don't want to hear this, like fast forward 15 seconds, he goes 66 days and wins the season. He's a former missionary, and the things that he said were just incredible to listen to. I resonated so much with it, which is why I reached out to him. And he was so gracious to spend time with us and share about his experience and how that time of spending that time on the island completely alone, he wasn't allowed to have his Bible with him. What did God do? How did God meet him in that moment? And what kind of scripture that he had memorized or not memorized came up? So in order to start this off, we talked a little bit about his experience of being a missionary in Brazil and how that prepared him for being on alone.
1999, we went to the city of Belo Horizonte, Brazil, which is the third largest city in Brazil, 5.5 million people. And I was a church planting missionary in the urban jungle. And I grew up in Pennsylvania, hunting, fishing, trapping, doing all that kind of stuff. I was very much into wilderness survival all through my teens and 20s and all that. And I kind of thought I was giving that up to go to Brazil and work in the third largest city in Brazil. Come to find out there's more wilderness surrounding that city than any place I've ever lived. It's amazing.
Really?
You got an hour outside the city and you are in the howling wilderness. And it was,
wow,
it was just beautiful. So I started a ministry down there called Perardua Wilderness Ministry, where I would take kids out into the jungle as using wilderness survival training as a springboard for spiritual development. And it was grueling. It was kind of like a rite of passage kind of thing. I didn't have to do anything artificial to make stress on them. The jungle does that on its own. But it was the kids divided themselves into people that had suffered in the woods with Pastor Mac and people that hadn't, so there was a long waiting list to get on into that experience, and it was wonderful. So yeah, that's kind of what I did. I was church planner, youth pastor, and wilderness survival instructor. Then 2008 we opened that up to paying customers, and as the Bushmaster Wilderness Survival School. So I did that as a tent making effort to survive the economic situation in the early 2000s there.
Okay.
It was good.
That's awesome. So then you came back, and we don't need to go through the story of how you got onto a loan, but let's fast forward to the fact that you're cast onto a loan. You can take 10 items, and I'm assuming it cannot be a book at all. Is that correct? Like what are you allowed and not allowed to bring on that?
They had a list of 40 items, and out of that 40 items, you could choose 10. And really, some of those items are really stupid. No one who knows what they're doing would ever choose those items. So if you look at the things people choose, it's pretty much in within 15 to 20 different items that people end up taking. And the rule was no books, no Bibles, no pens, no paper. They said if you have thoughts in your head, speak them. We want to hear your internal monologue and say what's on your mind. Don't just sit there in silence, and we don't want footage of you reading books or writing in your journal. Mm-hmm. So I knew that going in. They talked about that at boot camp, that we would not be allowed to bring Bibles because people asked. There were other believers who wanted to know if they could bring a Bible, and they had determined in season one that if a person was able to bring a Bible, that would be a source of spiritual help and comfort and psychological bulwarking, that it would give an unfair advantage.
Interesting.
In fact, one of the producers asked me during boot camp, I was doing an on-camera interview, and he had produced the first season. He says, Dave, do you think that your faith gives you an advantage over the other contestants? And I thought, wow, I never really thought of it as an advantage over other people in a competition. I said, that it is the source of strength for me. I know when I'm stressed, I hit my knees. When I'm stressed, I go to God for help. And that is, I don't know how people get through life without that. But as a something that I would hold over other people, I don't see it that way, because that same source of strength is available to them if they just go to Christ. Mm-hmm. And if they establish that relationship, they get all the benefits of being in Christ and knowing Him. And he liked the answer. You know, I don't know if he was a believer or not. But they recognized that Scripture is a source of comfort for people who believe in it, and they didn't want that unfair advantage.
So if faith was some kind of advantage, did not having your Bible with you, how did that affect that advantage, if at all?
Let me tell you the story of my last contact with Scripture before I dropped on the island.
Okay.
I got up that morning. I didn't wake up that morning. I got up because I hadn't slept all night, and just anticipating drop day. And I got up, and I knew I couldn't take my Bible, so I had my Bible there, and I just kind of riffed through it, and I set it on the bed open. Now, I am not a believer in Bible roulette.
Okay.
Like, just spin the Bible, put your finger in there.
Yeah.
But I did. I just opened it up, and it just so happens that Isaiah chapter 40 is pretty much in the center of that Bible. So when it laid open, it was open to Isaiah chapter 40. And in the NIV, it says, comfort for God's people at the top of the little title from the chapter. I thought, man, I could use some of that right now. I'm going to read this whole chapter. And I started reading the whole chapter. And I get down to verse 29, which is, He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Youths will grow weary and young men will stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings of eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. And I broke when I read that. I absolutely broke. I'm like, okay, Lord, that's what you're telling me? That's what you're telling me before I do this thing? Because this was not my first rodeo. You know, I've suffered in the woods before. I know what starvation feels like, and it's horrible. And I got out a pen. I took my rain jacket. I turned the hood inside out, and I wrote out those verses on the inside of the hood of my rain jacket. So that was right here over top of my head.
Really?
Right in my heart, my mind. Because I'm like, okay, Lord, if you're telling me that, you know exactly, you brought me to this place, you know exactly what's in store for me, and I think I'm going to qualify for weak and weary, you know. And there were times out there, I never once actually took that hood and opened it up and read those verses again. It was there. I know it was
interesting,
there, but I never actually read it. But I tell you what, there were times I'd be walking along and just so fatigued, and you're literally starving to death, you know, and I would start to quote that verse. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. And I could never say it out loud and get beyond those words before it broke me. Because I was just crying out that, God, Lord, I qualify here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I qualify for this. You've called me into this, and you've reduced me down to nothing. And I can't do this without your strength. If you don't lift me up, I will fall. And that is the fact. And that experience played out many, many times, especially in the first month, that I lost 35 pounds in the first 5 weeks or so.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Okay. Maybe this is TMI for the podcast. You might want to leave it in. I might want to leave it out, but I had my normal pre-bush diet dump on like day two. I was there, and I didn't have another dump for over a month. Over a month.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Yeah. And the crew was worried on me. They had me in medical check to be pushing on my stomach and saying, is there a blockage? I'm like, it's nothing in, nothing out, guys. I'm starving to death. I'm eating muscle tissue and fat. You know what I mean? There's nothing.
My goodness.
There's nothing. And that didn't start up again until I started eating seaweed and catching fish in large enough quantity. But not having Scripture, I was amazed at how much Scripture came to mind out there. Having been involved with Scripture on a daily basis for, you know, going on two decades.
Yeah.
It's there. You've got it in your head, and you are indwelled by the author of this book.
Yeah.
You know, and I know in some of your questions you had shared, you know, or being specific, I'm going back 8 years here. So there isn't a lot of things I would say that I remember this verse and that verse and things. And it came back. And it was just the Holy Spirit, the Lord working with me and me praying for my kids and praying for my situation and Him bringing up a lot of things, that traumas from the past and things like that. You really can't get away from when you're alone, truly alone. with no distractions whatsoever. And the memory of verses kept coming back again and again and again. He really does bring it to mind.
I think that's a real encouragement, because I know a lot of people, because it doesn't sound like you had made scripture memory like a specific discipline of yours prior to going out. And yet the time that you'd spend in the Word, God can still draw that out. Like the Holy Spirit was still able to draw that out in the moment. Is that right?
I would say the only time in my life I was really serious about scripture memorization was when I first, before I moved to Brazil, and during my first 2 years there, I was memorizing a lot of scripture in Portuguese.
Okay.
Because that had to be there. And it really helped me to, in speaking to people, to be able to quote verses rather than just go to my Bible and open it up and talk. And so I did a lot of scripture memorization in Portuguese. But I am not, your regular day job kind of guy who has limited exposure to the Word. I mean, the Word of God has been my
job. Yeah.
I don't memorize the manual on the car. If you're the mechanic, you know how to know what you're doing. You know what I mean? You know it's there. So there was a lot of interaction with the Word, far above what your average person who doesn't have that ministry task to do.
So I know we were talking a moment ago about how much footage is captured and gets edited down for these episodes of Alone. I mean, you were there for 66 days. 66, is that right?
66 days, yeah.
Yeah, 66 days.
I mean,
and it's
6 hours of raw footage a day.
And so we get to follow along with you as you go through the physical struggle, the starvation, and understanding that first month, just how it didn't seem like you were catching anything. You weren't getting anything. Can you speak to, one, a little bit of that physical struggle, but two, what was going on behind the camera, or maybe the stuff that didn't make the edit that was really powerful to you and you wish that story had been told?
Oh, there were points I intentionally, I don't want this story told by them. You trust them to edit your material and present an accurate version of you. And then the truth is, if they included every time I was crying about missing my kids, I'd look like a weepy little girl. And if they included everything where I was spot on and did the exact right thing, I'd look like a slick low drag operator. You know what I mean? It just, I think they did a pretty good job of presenting me as me, warts and all and everything. The one thing that really, really, really was necessary, for my relationship with the Lord was I had just been through a divorce. Mm-hmm. And, 2 years earlier I had, been through a divorce, lost my ministry in Brazil. It was, horrible. I mean, I didn't cheat on my wife, nothing like that, but there was some major, major stressors going on. It's a much more story than we have time for today.
Sure.
But I had lost everything. And I remember praying about 6 days in of sitting on a rock. And I said, Lord, you've taken everything away from me now. There is nothing left in my former life. I'm not a pastor. I'm not a missionary. I'm not a husband. I don't own my own home anymore. My life is just gone. And you've taken everything away from me. And the only thing I have left to lose is my life and my health. And you put me in the highest concentration of cougars and black bears on the planet with no weapon. I said, Lord, whatever you're doing here, I'm okay with it. Because obviously you brought me here. At boot camp, I told him, I said, Lord, if you don't want me to do this, because they show you everything about the show. And I'm like, I have to do this. This is the coolest thing I've ever seen. And I said, Lord, if you don't want me to do this, just pull back and let me fail at boot camp. Just take your hand off of me. Let me bumble around and be me. And they won't offer me a position. I said, because if they offer me a position, I am going to take it. All right, I'm just letting you know. You know how I think. You know how I make my decisions. If they offer me this position, you brought me here, I'm going to do it. So if you don't want that to happen, don't let it happen. All right. And he blessed me incredibly during boot camp. I mean, I was the only person at our boot camp that did everything in the time allotted in the field trial portion, So obviously he just blessed me there. So I'm sitting on the island and I'm like, Lord, whatever you're doing here, I'm okay with it because I've lost everything and you've literally now exiled me to a rock on the north end of nowhere with nothing. And I trust you, whatever you're doing here. And he proceeded to starve me down. talking about discipline and my lack of it, I've never really been a big faster either. I've managed a 3-day fast in the past, you know, but this was the
This is
effect
more than
of,
that.
it's like a 40-day fast. It was
Wow.
that level of starvation. I was trying to find everything I could get my hands on to eat, but
Yes.
that wasn't happening. Okay.
Yeah.
So I'm literally starving down like a 40-day fast. And at about day 30, this is the breaking point for me. I came out to check my gill net, which had not produced anything up to this point. And in the night, it had collapsed and rolled itself into a ball. And I was just furious. And I shut the camera off because I did not want to swear on camera. But it was in that hangry, spitting mood, you know what I mean? That anything's going to pop out here. It's punch a wall moment, you know what I mean? You're just frustrated.
Yeah.
And I got the ball of net out of the surf, and there was this enormous northern kelp crab in the middle of that ball of net. And I now have to untangle this net and get to this crab because I hadn't caught any at that point. And I started untangling this net, and I'm just getting angrier and angrier about it. That it's like everything I have ever taught anyone to do, how to survive in the wilderness, and getting your fishing infrastructure in, and your nets prepared, and your lines in the water, and just wave after wave of destructions, tearing it apart. And this is your life, isn't it, Dave? This is your life. You were a pastor, a teacher, Christian school teacher, and a missionary, and you served God with your life, and now you're here, and it's all gone, and it's destroyed. And let me show you how that happened. Let me show you your contribution, all that. And the Lord showed me. And you know, when you go through a divorce, you're in defensive mode. You're hearing about everything you ever did, and you're not buying any of it. You're not willing to engage anymore and consider, you know, yourself. And you're not. You're just trying to preserve any shred of your dignity you can, you know. And now, 2 years later, after starving me for 30 days, Lord kind of wrapped his arm around me and said, okay, let's take a look at this. Let's take a look at you in the midst of all that. You did make mistakes, didn't you? I didn't neglect my wife. I did make some bad choices and bad decisions for our family. And my ship sank and I was at the helm. And I had some confessing and repenting to do. And he graciously forgave me. And he led me through those one by one, you know. He gave me like a 5-minute break, and I look down, and there's a whole nother bucket full of rot down there. And there's people in that bucket, people that did things to our family that quite literally men kill over, okay? Things were done to my family that men seek revenge for and have plans to hide bodies for, okay? I'm just saying, is that serious? And that was me for a long time, okay? And I had just been forgiven. And now I look down and there's all these other people. And I have to forgive them. Because God didn't go to my ex-wife and ask her for permission to forgive me. He just forgave me. Because he paid for the sins of mankind, all of mine. He owns them, not me, not her. He doesn't have to consult her about forgiving me. Because he bled his life out and died on the cross for that. So he died on the cross for those people in that bucket too. And what are you going to do about it? Do you want to get your revenge? You want to turn this over, give place to the wrath of God for those people? Do you want to be the one to do it? Or do you want God to do it? You know, and one by one, he brought those people up, and I had to forgive them. And there's a lot of people there. And one by one, I forgave them, turned them over to God, and experienced the chains falling off of me for not having to carry that burden. He carries the burden of the people that did the horrible things. He paid the price for the people that did the horrible things. And I'm out of the equation now. And man, I tell you, Josh, after this, I was light as a feather. I had dealt with all of my internal garbage.
Yeah.
And he dealt with the bitterness and the unforgiveness and the murderous rage that I held towards more people than any man should have to. And he dealt with it. He lifted that burden off of me. And I was light as a feather. And I went back and I ate that crab. And I said, Lord, when I get out of here, I'm going to an all-you-can-eat crab place. I'm going to eat crabs. These are amazing. They eat dead stuff on the bottom of the ocean, and they taste like this. It's a miracle, right? It is. It is a miracle. They're the ugliest creature on the God ever made, and they're the sweetest tasting meat. You know, they're beautiful. And a couple of days later, I'm out fishing and standing on the edge of my reef there, and I look out in the the seaweed, and I spotted a kelp crab, and I caught him, and I caught five others that night. I caught six crabs that night, and they filmed that. That was they included that.
Oh yeah, I remember you holding that thing up.
Yeah,
Yeah,
yeah.
so exciting.
And I said, yeah, it's horrible for a Baptist to say. The only thing that can make this better is friends and beer. So, anyway, it was a great thing. It's like Laura was saying, you don't have to go home for all you can eat crab meal. We can do that. And I did that a lot. I started eating those crabs consistently after that. But yeah, the Lord took me out there to break me and to give me that experience of just taking me down to nothing and then building me back up. And as soon as I went through that experience with him on that beach about day 30, he turned the food back on. And I actually started regaining weight that I had lost. And actually, I didn't, regain to anywhere near my pre-drop day weight, but I was regaining. I got down to about 160 pounds, and I was on the mend from that. I was heavier than that when I won on day 66.
That's incredible. There are a number of things that I loved that the editors kind of pulled out from what you said. And it's one of the reasons I even reached out to you, because I resonated so much with parts of your experience having, our family was taken when we were serving in China, and there were, they had taken everything from us. And there was that, like the thing that they said pretty much in every single one of the intros of, who are you when everything is stripped away from you?
Right.
Right.
I was not thinking about that. I didn't say that in relation to the show.
Really?
I had been talking about all the stuff that I had lost recently in my life, and it all had fallen apart, and now I'm down to nothing. And I'm like, who are you when everything's stripped away? And it's like, now I get to literally do this in a very literal sense in front of the entire world, it seems.
Yeah.
And to me, it was just amazing when I look back on it that God broke me down to nothing in front of all those cameras all by myself. He took me down to nothing. And there was a lot of things I didn't film because it was just too personal. Like that day on the beach, I wasn't running the camera. As I'm weeping and crying out loud to God, I was talking to him out loud. I'm not just praying in my head. I'm just telling it to the world. You're all by yourself, and I'm not filming that for the world to see in detail like that.
Yeah.
I love telling that story now, but it some things are too personal to put on camera. But enough of the story comes through in the show. I'm very thankful they did not edit my Christianity out of me. And we don't want to show that part of this story. Yeah. It's very much there.
It is.
There were times I'd be preaching to that camera though.
Really?
I mean, at one point I actually apologized. I said, I'm sorry if this is getting too theological or too heavy for some of you guys, but you give me, I'm a pastor, I'm a missionary. You give me a camera, you say, let me hear your internal monologue. I said, this is what I think about. So I'm going to talk about it. So yeah, I'm talking about creation and evolution and all kinds of stuff. It just,
oh man.
Yeah. And the people that edited, I actually got to meet them and they really appreciated some of the things I was saying. They're like, I said, the one guy said, oh, you got to listen to all my insane ramblings. He says, sir, you've got some mighty interesting ramblings. So they were listening.
They were listening. Yeah. I can imagine that it would be, you don't get access to those tapes now, right? Like
footage. No.
Okay. Yeah.
They give me the paper write up because they watch it all, and they kind of chronicle what's in each scene, and they gave me that write up. It's like 95 pages long. It's really cool to go back in.
That's really cool. I kind of wish I'd had that for our experience. I feel like the thing that there's another quote that I want to read out that you said at the very end that also very much resonated with me, because I feel like, you go through an experience like that, and there's so much that God taught me in my personal experience that I don't think I would have been able to learn any way else, right? That breakdown period of you just got to get to a certain point in order for God to be able to say, okay, now I got you here. Now let's move up here. And if you don't mind, I'm gonna read this to you, back to you. This is what you said, but still, it I love it. It says, suffering has value. We avoid it at all costs. We would never want to go back and repeat it, but it has value. It's a part of life. Nobody goes through life without suffering. The question is, what do you allow that suffering to do in you? You can allow it to chew you apart, or you can look for the deeper meaning? Like, how does that sit with you now, 8 years plus later?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's even more so. My life's experience since then has entrenched that even more. You know, I've had a lot of people say, oh, you must have had these really deep spiritual insights when you got to the island. It's like, no, I've been through a lot in my life, and these were lessons I had already learned that I was able to just completely stand upon by faith when I got to the island. You know what I mean? It was not a question of, will God take care of me? Is God with me in the midst of my trials? I'm like, there is no doubt that that is the case. Yeah. You know, so yeah, the suffering, what do you allow it to do? You are going to go through suffering. And I have seen people turn and shake their fist at God over that. And how can they do that when you look at Christ? You know what I mean? I remember going to a hospital one time, and there was a girl who was really having a pity party for herself, and she was under some serious stuff. But when I found her, she's sitting there with two guys that are double amputees, and they're trying to encourage her. Okay. And I got back to her room, and I said, you know, she's woe is me and all this stuff. And I said, you know, you're going to pull yourself out of this. You got to find somebody here who's worse off than you and go encourage them every day. Mm-hmm. Find somebody here. And she thought about it. She says, well, what if I turn to the side and I find nobody who's suffering worse than I am? I said, oh, that seat's occupied by Jesus Christ, who bore the sins of the entire world. And he's the one who's going to hold you together, and he's going to encourage you.
Yeah.
Okay. And that's the case. You know, that you're going to go through suffering. So what are you allowed to do? Do you shake your fist at God, or do you go into the clinch? You know, because at that point in my life, I was thinking, I felt like I've been T-boned in the intersection of life, right? Everything's destroyed. Everything's gone. I'm laying there in the smoking wreckage, and I see the face of Jesus looking down at me in the smoking wreckage. I say, Lord, I just got hit by a truck. He's like, I know. I was driving it. You know? I did this with you. This is a controlled demolition here.
Yeah.
My life was a controlled demolition. He knew exactly how he was taking me down. Okay? I was never not in his hands through all that. I remember coming home to my shelter at night, and I had caught a fish or two, and it was dark. It was after dark, and it's cold, and I'm standing there in my shelter, and I am just gassed. I have nothing left physically to make a fire. I'm emotionally and physically overwhelmed with the prospect of making a fire and cooking these fish.
Wow.
Okay, and I remember just standing there in the shelter, and I had the headlight on, and I was in front of my chopping block in the wood pile, and I'm just staring at it, and I just can't do it. I can't bring myself to do it. Okay, I'm done. And I'm like, Lord, I can't do this. And he says to me, clear as a bell, my voice, my head, not my idea. You can put a piece of wood up on that chopping block, can't you? I said, yeah, I can do that. So I reached down and put a piece of wood on a chopping block. I'm just standing there. He says, hit it with the axe. You can do that, right? You can hit it with the axe. I can hit it with the axe. I can't build this fire. I can't do this. I'm in my end. Yeah, I can hit that with an axe. So boom, I hit it with an axe. The two pieces of wood fall to the side. Well, pick one of them up and put it on the chopping block. You can do that, right? Josh, literally, he talked me through every stage of making this fire. Until it's sitting there and it's glowing and the fish are boiling away and making stew. And, yeah. You know, you talk about saying grace. You know what I mean? Thank you, Lord, for this food. Bless our bodies. Yada, 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 you know.
Yeah.
I didn't do that a lot out there because it was in that attitude of prayer all day long. Mm-hmm. You know, Lord, I'm starving to death. I haven't eaten in 2 days. You know, give me this day, my daily sea perch, you know, and it was that constant connection. It was a lot of prayer all day. Mm-hmm. You had no one else to talk to. So talk to God, and he's great. He's a, you know what I mean? He knows. And it was good. Really was good. I mean, the emotion of catching a fish or crabs or whatever, you know, and knowing that God's taking care of me, you know, his hand is on me. He's taking care of me. And at the end, the last week I was there, I had a meal. Again, the moment that God talked to me, I go out, there's one little tiny fish in the morning, and I fish the day 64. I fish all day long. I'm catching nothing. Go to check all my crab places. Nothing. I'm getting skunked. They've got this one little fish. It's like 6 inches long. And I get home. I'm on my way home. And I stopped at the last place on my northwest coast that I could fish. It was good for fishing. And I could watch the tide come in. And there was like a cliff there. And if I waited too long, I couldn't get back to my camp. I had to go when the water was at a certain point. And I could see it from that spot. So I got my head down. I'm grumbling. It's sleeting. I'm not filming. I'm just angry. And I'm kind of grumbling at God. I'm like, Lord, I'm not learning anything new here. It was day 64. And someone else obviously is suffering just like I am. And I'm not learning anything. I don't know what new lessons, what more of this is going to teach me. I don't know what's going on, but it's really starting to suck, you know? And again, my voice, my head, not my idea. Go down, stand on that rock and cast into the bull kelp. Loud and clear. And yeah. I look up, I look down, and there's a flat rock down there by the water. I'm like, well, that's dumb. Why would I cast into bull kelp? I just put my head down, start grumbling again. Go down, stand on that rock, and cast into the bull kelp. Loud and clear. Not optional. Okay. I go down. I cast in bull kelp. Is floating rope. It's very, you lose hooks in bull kelp, right? So okay. I cast out into a hole in the bull kelp, and the wave washed out towards the sea again, and I was hooked in the bull kelp, and it just rock solid, stuck in the bull kelp. I'm going to lose a hook. I'm just like going nuts. And another wave came in, and the bull kelp came in with the wave, you know, but my line was still headed out to sea really hard. And I haul back on the line, and this sea perch comes out of the water as big as my Bible. You know, just he lands in the rock behind me, and I stab him to death and everything. And yeah, that perch gave me a quart of filleted meat in my pot. I had a 2-quart pot. Half of it was just fish meat that night.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. I could barely finish it.
Tasted so good, too, I'm sure.
Oh, my God. I could barely finish it. I was like, I had a couple meals out there that were so big, I could just like barely get it all down. And that was one of them. And that was day 64. That was the day that Larry actually left. And yeah, I didn't know. I thought at that point somebody was sleeping on a bearskin rug with trained sea otters bringing them crabs every, you know, I mean, someone out there is doing fantastic.
Yes.
And yeah, but it was me. I was doing really good at that point. It's a hand-to-mouth subsistence level. I did not, like, you see other guys on Alone who have, like, stockpiles of frozen fish and half a moose and all this stuff. I was hand-to-mouth. I never had food to prepare and store in any way. Yeah. I ate what I caught. I caught everything I could, and I ate everything I had every
immediately.
Day. It's hard to analyze why you won. Mm-hmm. It's easier to analyze failure than it is to analyze success. But I would say that my faith absolutely held me together out there. My faith that God would provide kept me motivated to go out and look. God doesn't want me to starve to death, but I have to catch the fish, right? So God will provide for me. Therefore, I am going to get up out of this sleeping bag. I am going to search my environment. I am going to engage with the wildlife. I'm going to do what I need to do for God to bless me in it. You know, and that definitely was a motivator. Having him to talk to constantly was huge for my strength. Having scripture come up, bubbling up like a well whenever I needed it, that was huge. Source of comfort, you know, that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When that word of God bubbles up, it strengthens your faith. When you remember what he said, okay, I can rest in this. I can depend upon this, you know? And so those things were definitely, but that said, that wasn't something I took with me out to the bush. That's something I learned through my previous years. I didn't, suddenly, jumpstart that engine out there. That had been, got to put me through the ringer in a lot of different ways to teach me those lessons, but they hold. And now to think that he brought me through all those different things to put me out there in front of so many people, that is very humbling to think that he planned that all along.
And that he was able to use you in that way to kind of share that kind of message. Yeah.
Well, we say things like that, that he was able to use me, and now, that's what I needed for me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's what he had to do for me to get me to engage with him, to get me to bend the knee, to get me to repent, to get me to forgive. He had to bring me through those things to teach me those lessons. And it is amazing that he put me in a place where I was all filmed, you know, and now it's out there for millions of people. That's very humbling that he would do that. And, you know, people think, oh, the money, that was really a blessing. And it wasn't life changing. It definitely got me out of, you know, debt free and all that. Yeah. The one thing recently, which my daughter brought to my attention, is my exit video, the one that's out on YouTube. Is a perfect metaphor for the rapture. You know, if you believe in a pre-trib rapture, here's this guy, you know, going through, you know, everything I say in there. If you think, okay, this is a metaphor for the rapture. Okay, go back and watch that video. Everything I say in there, everything that happens.
Yeah.
You know, because here I am. I want to be found when the Lord comes back. I want to be found head down in the work, working for him, right? Doing what I'm called to do. And he knows he's coming back tomorrow. Okay, fine. But what does he call me to do next week? That's what I'm focused on. I'm doing this thing. You know, this next week I'm going to a conference in Dallas. Okay, he can come back right now. But if he doesn't, I'm going to a conference in Dallas. And I mean, we're building a high school. We're doing all these different things. It's like I'm standing there and my plan for the day was to go out on my North Shore, Northwest coast, and take my gill net and lay it down over a big crack out there in the so when it would flood, anything going in and out of that crack is going to get in that net, crabs and all kinds of stuff. And they're there doing that exit interview, you know, they're doing that interview with me, talking to me about TV stuff. And my daughter walks up and I turn around and there's my daughter standing there and I'm done. This is all over. All this is done. Everything that I've been doing, all my plans, all my hard work, I'm out of here. And I get to go in a helicopter now. I soared out of there on wings of eagles. You know what I mean?
Oh, that's awesome.
All the metaphors are there. Yeah. And they just came and just harpazo, just pulled me out of my cove. And now I'm in a cabin and I got like, you turn a knob and flames appear. You lift a lever and water falls. You know what I mean? It's just like... You want it to be warmer, you just turn up the thermostat. I actually turned the heat off in there because I couldn't stand being inside. Oh my goodness. It was horrible.
Really? That's
crazy. Just being inside. I felt like someone was forcing their hands over my eyes and ears.
Wow.
You know, because you develop this 100-yard circle of attention around you because you're a prey species out there. You're not the top predator.
Yeah.
And you're aware of everything going on around you for about 100 yards radius. Yeah. I mean, you know everything that's happening. And you get inside and all of a sudden there's this thing buzzing, the heater's moving,
That's terrible.
Inside. I would put on my dirty bush clothes and go sit outside in the frost on the deck of the cabin just because I couldn't be inside. And then when I come home to my apartment, it's still going on like a week later, you're like, I still couldn't stand being inside. So my apartment was on the first floor and there was a little pond out front, out behind the apartment. And so I'd sitting on my patio and it's like 11:30, 12 o'clock at night. And I just can't be inside. And this duck comes steaming up. It was like December 4th or 5th. And this duck comes paddling up to the side of the lake and he's going to hop out of the water right in front of me. He's maybe 10 feet away. I radar locked on that duck. I was going to kill that duck. I was just, everything in me is like, he's here, he's in range, I can get him. Dude, slow your roll. Calm down, man. You got a whole bag of tilapia in the freezer. You got food. You got peanut butter and jelly, man. Don't kill the duck.
Yeah, but that's so funny.
It feels good to be that guy. It feels good to be that instinctual, that primal.
Yeah,
you know, I bet. You don't get an opportunity to do that in life, and that doesn't happen if you just go out for a hike or something. You don't convert into that primal Homo sapiens 1.0 program.
Dave, you bring up a good point. And I want to ask one more question, because most of us are not going to be put in the position that you got to be put in, right? In good and bad ways. Most people, even when I tell my story, are never going to find themselves in a Chinese prison and kind of, you know, in kind of this weird situation. So is there anything that you particularly learned, like any lessons that you learned either teaching survival or going through this that that you think are more easily applied to our Christian life or the way that we go through day-to-day life, things that we forget or things that are important to prepare for?
Sure. I would say the number one thing I have learned before going to the bush and then applied it absolutely on Vancouver Island is that God doesn't actually give us strength. He is our strength. Okay. You're not going to get everything you need to go through chemo when you pray that first time and say, Lord, you know, I need you to go through this. It's not like he writes you a giant check at that point and says, okay, here's all the strength you're going to need. Here's all the resources you're going to need. Here's all the comfort, all the love, all the encouragement you're going to need. Now parcel it out as best you can during your ordeal. Okay? Mm-hmm. He is those things for us as we abide in him. As I abide in him moment by moment, he is for me everything that I need to be moment by moment.
That was such a fun conversation for me, and I hope that you enjoyed listening in. You can learn more about Dave's ministry, which is Set Free Ministries or setfreemen.org. I want to explain it. I'll let him explain a little bit of what they do right here.
We are a spiritual freedom ministry. A freedom appointment here is you'll sit down with two brothers or sisters in Christ, and they will lead you through a seven-step process of confession and repentance and getting things right with God. And it's fantastic because people carry all kinds of stuff. You know, all that stuff I was carrying on the island. You know, that was my freedom appointment, you know, where I God engaged with me. But there is a huge, huge difference between carrying those things, those traumas of the past, and getting it all out and speaking it out loud and actually forgiving and receiving, renouncing sin of your past, or hidden sin, and then getting right with God.
Again, you can go to setfreemen.org. And if you want to see Dave on Alone, it's on Hulu right now. Season 2 is the one where Dave is on Vancouver Island and spends 66 days there. It really is worth just the time. It's maybe a little bit intense for some families, but a lot of fun to watch. Really clean and just a great season to go and check out if you haven't. Thank you for taking time with me today. If you want to watch more great interviews, we've got that right here. And if you are interested in memorizing more of the Bible, I've got some videos on how you can do that right here. God bless.